first thing. So
oh, yes. Yeah, sure.
Applause. I'm going to do it one more time.
I thought I took it out.
Save on champagne.
Turn me on, Nick.
Oh, I like that.
it builds up. You got that build up. There it goes. Save on this though.
Yes.
Yes.
Is it just Save On, or is it, you have to put it all together?
It's so just Save On.
Okay.
Yeah. Like the store Save On?
Like the store Save On.
Shut up.
But I was first.
No hyphen?
I think I was first.
Yeah, I think
no hyphen. Just Save On.
S-A-V-O-N.
With two N's. Oh, so you got two N's.
Yeah, I got two N's.
Right.
So I would have been going Save On and then. Say Nama and then.
Kind of close, like.
So, Seva, who the last time we saw you, and yes. I thought you were here because he was like, you guys got no place. I'm like, what are you saying? Like, was at Borders.
Yes.
That was like almost two and a half years ago.
Yes.
Because little
Dale is 18 months.
And he was in the womb then. Because Savon was how we found out she was pregnant.
Well, I thought she.
Well, she knew, but she hadn't told anybody, remember? So he said it, and then he talked about how her first baby's father would be there in the room with her when she had the baby, and she was crying. But that was amazing. She talked about that. That paid impact on
her. Turn his mic up, Nick. Turn his mic
up. I remember saying that.
Yep.
And then you said that we wouldn't be there, I think.
Yeah, he said that we would be leaving.
Yep.
And what did we say?
We said...
I pinched you.
Oh, you sure did. Oh, you said. I was like, where are we going to be? We don't know. We'll be here next week.
Right.
Wow. So what have you been doing since then?
Just working on my gift, traveling, going to London a lot. I go to a school out there that actually teaches.
Oh, really?
Mediumship. Yeah.
Really?
He's
like,
so
are you late for class now? I mean,
no. It's in London.
It's in London, and usually when I go, I'll go for a couple of weeks, and then I come back. So mediumship and spiritualism is like a big part of their culture over there. It's been around forever. So they have schools, and you go and you live there for a week or a couple of weeks and learn about spirit and spirituality, and then I come back. And,
do it on me?
Yeah.
Because he's blessed me a lot. Because you remember,
I've heard that before.
you remember when I did my one-woman show, my mother again, after my mother passed, I kept trying to write it. It wasn't written. And I kept trying to write it because I was turning 50, and I was like, I got to do something. I got to do my show. I got to do my show. And Savon called me. You called me about something, and I called you back, and you said, Tanja, I know you didn't call me about this, but your mother's here. You told me about all the people that were present.
I remember that.
You remember that? You told me.
I was asking for some advice about
stay close to my
stuff. Yes.
For some advice about reality TV.
Yes.
Because that's not my world. And I thought, let me call Tanji because she'll probably
know. Wanted you to do?
Yeah, producers contact me all the time. Oh, and wow. I'm just not, I can't be bought.
So what's the dude, Tyler? Is that his name?
Yep.
On E?
Yeah.
So you guys basically do the same thing, right?
We do the same thing, but we work differently.
Okay.
Yeah. All mediums work in their own way.
Uh-huh.
So, and the thing about mediumship is, you know, mediumship by definition just simply means communication with those who are no longer here in the living, but they're on the other side. The purpose of mediumship is to prove continuity of life and to prove that we don't die, that there is a living spirit that connects us all together. But the only way to prove that is by giving information that we call evidence. So a lot of on that show, and I think some of what I did the last time I was here was when I'm able to just say things and there's no way that I would know it.
Right.
That's what we call evidence.
Uh-huh.
And that's what proves that your loved ones are still around because they're the ones that are communicating to the medium. The medium is just a vessel, just a straw that information and emotions flow through me. So some mediums work a lot for practical information, so they'll say practical things. Some mediums are very emotional, so they'll only talk about emotional things, but it's all mediumship, and it's the soul of the person who is no longer here that will bring through the message in the way that they feel it will best connect to
connect
you.
To
so with, I know this with Tyler, like you have to give him an object or something.
You don't have to give him.
You have to give him.
That's psychometry.
Okay.
That's where you psychometry. Hold on to an
object. Write this shit down.
Because everything has energy, right? Everything is energy. Physics has already proven that. And so when you have an object that belongs to someone that they've held onto or they've used, it has has an energetic imprint in it, and so psychics and intuitives are able to hold on to that and read the energy in the object, and it's used as a gateway to connect to someone or something. So that's how that thing works.
Oh, okay.
I know when my kid's mom passed away, like that first month after she passed away, I felt she woke me up to take the kids to school. Because I don't know what was up, you never grabbed it. And my son, every once in a while, he breaks down. But then he'll be okay. Madison, she knows her mom right here. And Maya, just, she has a daughter.
Well, she puts it on social media
on
anniversaries.
So in situations like that, do you want to talk to the kids, or you talk to the parents and tell the kids about their mom?
Oh, that's interesting.
That's a good question. I think it depends on how old the child is. Mm-hmm. And I'm not a parent, so I think it depends on how old the child is, but I think there's a way to explain to a child that their parent isn't there physically.
But I can tell you something about her.
Yeah, I can tell you something about her, or they're still here. Like, mommy, you know, let's set up a picture and an altar and light a candle for mommy. The holidays are coming up. Let's get a candle. Like, so doing little things like that to still connect them to the memory of the parent is good, and it gives them something to hold on to so they don't feel like there's just nothing there.
But would you do a session? Would you, if he wanted to do a session with his kids, would you do that?
No, because this is the thing. I'll be 42 in May, and I've been doing this since I was 20. Like, I've been studying. I've been focused on my craft for so many years. There's an ethical and ethical part that comes with what I do, but then you have to have integrity. And so for me, I would never do a reading on a child simply because they don't have the lived experiences and the mental and emotional foundation to be able to handle the information that's coming through.
Okay.
So if I was to ask you what their mom, what I should tell them their mom, like Brooklyn.
You can read him.
Yeah. But the only thing is kids. The mother tells him what to say, so he can't just...
That's what I'm asking.
Oh, yeah, but he'll tell you. If she talks to him, then he'll tell you what she says.
That's what I'm asking.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, like, if I did a reading with you, what almost always happens is the parent will always bring through messages and reference the child. So whenever I do a reading, I never like to put any parameters on it. I just say I'm going to open up, and whatever's meant to come through will come through. Sometimes children are acknowledged. Sometimes they're not. But in some way, shape, or form, a message will come through to acknowledge one of the children. And so, like, even as I talk to you and we talk about her, we're calling it her energy, so I'm automatically aware that there's a birthday coming up. Yes? There's a birthday.
One of your children
has a birthday that's coming up.
August.
Okay? And so right away, and I want to use this as a teaching moment, as you and I are talking, I'm not even trying to connect, but when you ask me the question, I immediately became aware of her. So she's here with me, and as she's here with me, the first thing she told me is there's a birthday that's coming. You know, and I know that the birthday is connected to a girl. Yes. And the only way that I was
aware of
that...
He got a lot of kids.
Well, when...
So he had to figure
for
out.
For charity, it would be Zari.
But with regards to the context of this conversation, which is, am I connecting with your child's mother? Her child's birthday is coming up. I didn't know that. I didn't even know the name of your child, right? And so that right there is what we call evidence. Okay. That's how we know that, you know, she's here, because she's given me that information. You know.
And the last time he was here, didn't he say the month or something?
Well, I kept asking you, how do you connect to M or May?
Yes,
or Maya,
and
or
he kept saying, I don't. And, May.
But then later
we realized that's the child's name.
I forgot all about that.
Yeah.
Can't retain that. I'll forget my social security number.
Keep it in your pocket. Forget where you put it. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
But that's how it works. Okay. You know, and so they come through, and she's still here with me, and the more that I just allow myself to just connect with her, I'm also aware that one of your children either just celebrated a milestone, completed something with school recently, that that you guys were celebrating.
Oh my God.
Yeah. You know, because I know that I'm there crazy. And I can see us all celebrating and we're excited and we're happy. We're telling her how proud of her we are. Would you understand that?
Yeah.
See, and so again, that's evidence that she's here. And when I work, Tyler's a little bit different, and a lot of these mediums on TV are different. Because I've been doing this for so long, and because I take what I do seriously, and because there's so many people that are untrained, that are just fake, I don't ask questions when I work. I just make factual statements. If I make a factual statement and you answer yes, I'm not doing any tricks to get the information. I'm just allowing myself to connect with her, and I'm allowing her to lead me. I'm allowing the spirit to lead me. And so I wanted to use it as a teaching moment to show you that that's how it works. There's nothing evil about it. There's nothing wicked about it. Again, it proves that she's still around. She's still very much involved in your life, in her children's lives. And so, you know, you asked me earlier, what message would I say? I would tell her that, you know, her mother brought up, her birthday's coming. She brought up that she recently had a celebration, but she was there for that. So she's not missing anything. She's not missing the birthday. She's not missing the things that go on in school. You know, she's not missing anything.
All right. So when someone reaches out to you, I guess you're online. How does someone?
You can go to his website.
People reach, be honest, people these days find me all kind of ways. It's crazy.
And they set up a session with you. Like, yeah, wanna...
They'll go to my website. They'll pay for the session. They'll book a session. And then I don't like to know any personal information about anybody. And then we'll do it either FaceTime, Skype, or over the phone. And if we do it over the phone, I always record every session that I do so people can have it. Because I'm that confident in my ability, but I'm not confident in spirit. It's not about me. I know that spirit is going to come through when it's time for spirit to come through. But I record it because a lot of times within an hour, no one's going to remember every single detail. Like, I don't even remember half the stuff that I say.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's good to have it because it gives you a piece of them again. And then you can have it to play over and over again. And sometimes you want to listen to it. Sometimes you might miss something. Sometimes I might say something and you might be like, I don't know what that is. And nobody knows what it is. But then later 6 months later, it's like, you know. So, yeah, that's why I'm calling.
Because I didn't even know it was a girl's celebration, too.
Because you're not.
I know. I wonder, like somebody made a joke and said, have you ever been bombarded with spirits like Ghost? Like Whoopi Goldberg and Ghost?
Sometimes. It depends. If I'm in a really crowded place, so I don't go out a lot. I used to go out a lot. If I'm in a really crowded place, like I don't go to clubs because I'm hypersensitive. So what that means is I'm not sensitive in the sense that you can't, like, John on me. I'm going to start crying. Like, you could do that.
Well, you're a psychic.
But I'm sensitive energetically. So if I go into a club and people are in there drinking and doing whatever, I can feel their suffering. Right? Because to be a medium, in order for me to deliver the messages to you, I have to experience it myself. So she's not just telling me that there's a birthday coming up. I'm experiencing it as if I know there's a birthday coming up. I know that we just had a celebration. You know, so I don't want to be experiencing everybody's emotions and thoughts and energy.
That makes sense.
So my question is, okay, so all of us, we have somebody that, you know, has passed in our life very, very close to us.
Right.
So would for me, it's my mom. Would my mom, if she's in the room, would you say, hey, can you tell her this? Or do I have to, like, come to you? Or, you know what I'm saying? Or is it, it could be any one of us or anybody's spirit. You know what I'm saying? We know there's three right now. Your mother, my mother,
right.
Baby mom. So... if they won't have something to say, would they just come to you and then you just have to tell us?
Sometimes.
Okay.
Sometimes it depends. So I'll give you an example. I do events called mediumship demonstrations. Mm-hmm. And so what a demonstration is what I just did with speeding. It's a way to demonstrate how it actually works, how it can help you, and how it can impact your life if you choose to work with me privately. But it's in a public forum where people come and sit, but not everybody gets a message. So what determines that is up to spirit, but it really has a lot to do that I find with just the needs of the individual, the needs of the spirit world, and then just me being open to it. It's just random. I don't ever know who I'm going to give a message
to.
I just know I'm feeling something, and I'm supposed to talk with somebody, you know. But I know your mother's around. Mm-hmm. You know, I felt her when I was in my car meditating before I came here.
And when
so
she
I
said,
knew that I
mama,
was
gonna, what mama said?
I knew that... was going to come up. Uh-huh. And so, if just answer yes, no, or don't.
Okay.
So, as I blend with your mother, one of the things your mother shows me about her character is I know your mother was a woman that had strong faith, and there's a connection with church with your mother. Would you understand that?
Yes.
Okay, and your mother also was involved in the church. Would you understand that?
Yes.
Okay, and so that's what I get right away, right? And so that lets you know my mother's with him, because Savon didn't know that he didn't know my mother. I'm aware that your mother wore reading glasses, okay? Because
yes.
She's standing right there with glasses on. Right? And so that's how I know. I want you to know that she's here. I'm working outside of the box of how I normally work, because I want to use this as a teaching moment.
Uh-huh.
But I know there's an urgency for you to really know that your mother's around you. Right? And so, and I know that towards the end, I'm already aware of how she passed, because it was on social media, so I want to be transparent about that. But one of the things that your mother shows me is I know that you were there with her for medical problems. And I know that it wasn't easy to be with her and to watch her, but I know that you were being strong for her, because she shows me. She shows me in my mind, I have this image in my mind, and I see I'm there with your mother, and you. So it's like she takes me back to the room. And I know that it wasn't easy for her. And I know that it was tiring for her, but you kept her strong. You know, and I know that you stepped in where your father couldn't step in. Correct? So she shows me all these things. And so one of the messages is thank you for being strong for me. But I also know that in the same way that Tangie helped her mother, I know you did a lot of things for your mother in a nursing capacity,
uh-huh.
as if you were her nurse.
Uh-huh.
I know that you wanted to do that. You didn't want anybody else to do that, right?
Right.
She shows me that. You know, and I'm not going to go into the details because it's too personal, but I can see it. And I'm feeling it as if I'm doing it for her myself. So I know that there was a close bond. I know that you took care of her. I know towards the end there were difficult decisions that needed to be made, because she shows me that. She shows me medical documents. That means for me that there's medical decisions that I'm responsible for that affect whether she stays or leaves. And I know that you had to do that. I know that wasn't easy. I also am aware with your mom that there must have either been, just say yes, no, I don't know. There must have been a change of the medication, or there was something that happened where she had a reaction to it and we had to figure out what was going on.
Yes.
Because I know I had this feeling like I want to throw up, or this feeling like I'm not feeling like myself and something's wrong with the medication. So she makes me aware again that it was something that she did, but you know, she didn't enjoy doing. She took the medication, but there were adverse reactions to it, and we had to figure out what was going on. And I know that it was like several times we're asking the doctors what's going on, what do we need to do. So she's bringing that up because I need you to know that everything that happened exactly the way that it was supposed to happen. So you have to tell yourself, I know that I did right by mom, and I know that there's nothing else that we could have done differently. And she's at peace, which is the most important thing. She just wants you to be at peace. She's at peace.
Okay.
You know, you did everything that you needed to do. There isn't anything different. If there was, she'd be telling it to me, but
right.
She's not.
Right.
And so a lot of the times when we have a parent that we have to take care of and they're sick,
yeah.
and we're going back and forth, sometimes we feel guilty, or we feel like, you know, I wonder this, I wonder that. And she just wants you to know that you did everything you needed to do, and that she's at peace. And she accepts that it was her time. But she's very much involved in you. She's always around you. She's never not going to be around you. You know, and I'm also aware with you, like I was with Speedy. I don't know if this is a birthday, but I know that there would be an anniversary or something that would be coming up. Because I can see the symbol of the cane in front of you. And to me, as I feel into it, I'm feeling celebration is something that we're commemorating, something that we're
celebrating.
Something that we are celebrating and commemorating is what I want this to say.
Right.
Would you understand that?
Yes.
Okay. So, she'll be there for that. And I need to also say that I'm proud of you. You know this already. I'm just telling you, you know, I'm just passing this. This is just what's coming through. And this is how it works. It's not like I'm guessing or anything. I'm just relaxed.
Right.
But I'm tuned in to my soul awareness, which allows me to connect to her. You know, I have to say this. Sometimes spirits, if they don't trust you, they don't like you, they're not going to come through. So I'm lucky because they know I'm not full of shit. You know, and I'm being real. Like, they know that my heart is in this.
Right.
Like, Tanji's mother came to me and told me a lot of personal things that I shared with her. Just like your mother right now, who I know wasn't a woman that would tell, want everybody to know her business.
Not at all.
And I know you're private also, but she's given me glimpses of personal things that other people don't know. Because she trusts me to be able to deliver this to you. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm going to leave it with that.
Okay.
So if you're just tuning in.
I know that was a lot.
No, no, no. This is all good.
That's good. Have they sending you chat room hugs?
Well, I'll just guess on it.
Okay, I have a question. So, you know how you said, like, if you go in a club, you can feel, like, people's, like, depression or whatever?
Yeah.
Can you shut that off? Like, can you
sometimes
not be connected?
So, sometimes I can and sometimes I can't. And I always say this. Everybody is created and designed to do what it is that they're called to do. So, me being a medium and being psychic means my hypersensitivity depends on that. That's what fuels it. So, and to shut that down means I'm shutting me off. I'm just sensitive by nature. I've always been sensitive. But I never understood it until I started to understand why I was so sensitive and why I could see colors and see things and feel things. And then once I accepted that it wasn't anything negative, that it was actually a gift to help people and empower people, then things started to change. But can I turn it off? No, because even if I'm having a conversation, I can still be aware of other stuff going on around me. And especially in a club environment, it's amplified because people are drinking. And then when I drink, then it's just not good. So I just, like, I have to protect my gift and protect my energy.
Yeah, so how do you stay, like, grounded? Because, like, do any, like, evil spirits or anything, like, come to you?
No, so for me, this is just what's true for me. I don't really believe.
Okay.
And I believe that if you live right, if you live from love, then you attract love.
Okay.
I think the only evil that we think exists is in our minds.
It's true.
It's in our own consciousness. And I haven't ever really been in a situation, not to say it doesn't exist, but I haven't been in a situation where something evil but malevolent has been present. Usually it's some fear that someone has that's so strong that that's what they believe, that that's what it is.
Okay, so you would say fear.
I would say fear.
Okay.
Everybody has somebody around them. Nobody's alone, even the homeless man on the street.
Right.
I can stop at a stoplight and I'll look over and I'll see that there's someone with him. It could be an angel or it could be one of his loved ones, but none of us are ever alone. And so that's what also mediumship shows, because I think most of us feel like we're alone in our own circumstances. How am I? What's my next step? What's my next move? I need to figure it out. But if we would just relax and recognize, wait a minute, I have help. I have my ancestors. I have this, the God within me.
Right.
Right. Then it would be a lot easier. So what I try to do is let people do what I'm doing. Right. Because now you can go through the rest of your day and the rest of your journey knowing your mom is with you every step of the way. And when something doesn't feel right, you know it's her. You know with your daughter's mom that she's with you as well, helping you with kids but also helping you with business stuff as well. And so what that does is that empowers you to listen and to trust yourself. Y'all don't really need me, right? You really don't, but I'm just here to be an intermediary between the spirit world and the living so you can be empowered. And that's the way it's supposed to work. It should never foster codependency where you feel like I can't make a move until I talk to Savon. No, I'm going to tell you what it is that you need to work on within yourself so that you can be empowered and you can listen to the God within you and then go make those moves that you need to make, knowing that you have your team behind you.
Okay. So when you're dating, how do you keep yourself from wanting to tell somebody?
I don't.
Like, you got 20 people next to you.
I can't fuck with you.
I don't. I've had bad experiences in the past that I learned from. You know, where I've dated, I'm gay, so I dated guys, and and, you know, once they find out what I do, the first question is, who's around me? Like, people are always curious about who's around me, and I told this one guy that his grandmother was with him, and I started telling him information, he just started crying, and I was like, fuck.
You ain't gonna do nothing tonight.
Yeah, I know. Like, you don't get it in. It was gonna just, I'm weird about it, and I'm still weird about it, because this is the thing. What I do is still very controversial, right? Yeah. And we live in a country that is extremely religious, and people just don't understand it. And so they see it as something as evil and wicked, and, you know, even when I was a kid, people used to say, well, demons can make believe that they're your loved ones.
Yeah.
You know, but there's nothing wicked about me. You can feel that in my energy and in my heart. And so there's a lot of, it's hard to date. It's hard for me to date because, number one, I read people's energy quick. So I know if somebody's full of it or not. I know if someone's still attached to certain behaviors and proclivities that keep them from being honest and being monogamous.
Right.
I'm going to see it. So I always tell people, if you're going to be my friend, just be yourself.
Right.
And I don't read people without their permission, but just be yourself and like, love me. Because I'm going to love you, like, 1,000 times harder. And if you need me for anything, I'm going to be there for you. So sometimes it's hard to make friends because people are afraid.
But when do you tell them that you have that gift? Do you just... Do you automatically
know
how you're doing?
No, because I'm on social media.
No, even if, let's say I wasn't on social media, I didn't do any of that.
The baby.
The babies. And if I never did that and someone met you, do you automatically go, hey, how you doing? I'm so-and-so.
I don't say that. I just, sometimes I don't even say anything. I just say I help people.
Okay.
Sometimes I'll say I'll help people.
Okay.
If it's someone that I can feel has issues, would have issues with what I do, I'll just lie and say I do IT work. Because I don't feel like getting in a back and forth over the legitimacy of what I do.
Right, yeah.
How you know it's real?
Right.
Right.
Right. And so,
don't ask me.
You know, and, but I don't, so I don't date, but I just think that I haven't met somebody who is cool enough in there with it to be cool with it.
He's coming.
Yeah, so.
Well,
off the record.
Yeah. No fun intended.
But it has to be somebody that has it together, because I'm going to know it. And I'm going to, like, I work with my ancestors a lot. I work with spirit a lot. That's what I do for a living. So if you think you're going to play me, I'm going to act like I don't know nothing, but I already know what's up, because they're going to tell me.
So why can't they tell you where to go so you can meet somebody? Or is it that they don't want you to have somebody?
That's a good question. That's a good question. So, people think that when you're a medium or you're a psychic, then how come, you know, it doesn't mean that I'm ever going to have a perfect life. It just means I have an ability to tap into inner guidance to navigate certain experiences. I still have to live my journey, right? They can't do everything for me. They can't say, this is where your soulmate is. They can say, you be everything that you need to be, that you want to attract, and then let it happen, and then just trust. Because if they do everything for me, then I'm not going to learn anything. If they tell me every single thing, and I, like, how am I going to learn? How are any of us going to learn? So there's sometimes things that we need to go through to learn, to prepare us for the blessing that we're going to receive.
Speedy.
Hey, man.
So, remember we were saying that you had Red Sky?
Hey, I remember you. Hey.
Yeah, that's the baby that she was pregnant with.
That's the baby.
Oh my God.
Yeah. That's crazy, right?
Wow.
Really?
See, that was spirit that had her come today.
So, okay, this is so cool that she's here and y'all are bringing this up, because I didn't remember that. People also think that you can predict the future. Hey. And I always say, no one can predict the future. Sometimes in a reading, because the spirit world knows everything, sometimes a piece of information gets brought forward really to give someone comfort. So that message was brought forward, obviously, to give her comfort and so she can feel supported and know that she was going to be okay. But it wasn't predicting the future, because there's an infinitesimal amount of futures based on everything
that you, great words that he
everything that you do now. So let's say you get a reading with me, right? And then you get guidance, and then you start doing the work, the inner work, and you follow the guidance. The guidance is going to lead you to your desired outcome.
Yes,
that's now you're focused. But if you don't follow the guidance, nothing's going to happen.
So what is the difference in what you do in psychic way with the cards? Are they the same thing or just a different way of getting to it?
Does he do tarot cards?
Yeah.
So, it's just a different way of getting to it.
That's a good question.
Psychic Wayne is...
Can you?
Okay.
That's a great question. Okay. So let me separate the two really quickly. Mediumship is me talking to your mother, and I'm only talking to her, and she's giving me messages.
Got it.
So she describes her personality. She shows me things that she did in life and things, you know, with you and her relationship.
Right.
Mediumship.
Right.
Psychic is something different. Psychic is me tapping into someone's energy and I'm focused on them. And so there's a million ways to be able to do that. From my own understanding,
he's an astrologist too. He's an astrologist too. Ooh. Psychic Wayne.
Oh, nice, nice. Tarot cards are a tool, right? So the tarot cards go down, and each tarot card has a meaning. But also, as the psychic looks at the tarot cards, they're also getting messages about what that card means for the person. A lot of times when oracle cards are pulled, they represent what's going on in the unconscious mind. So psychic means, psych comes from the word psyche. The psyche is what's going on in your psyche that you may not be aware of, right? I'm stressed out, I'm not making money, what's going on with me? I'm completely unaware of what's going on in my subconscious mind. So you go to a legitimate psychic who can tap into your energy and help you to understand what's happening on a deeper level that you may not be aware of. And tarot cards can do that. I don't know much about astrology, but I know astrology works in a very similar way where you look at the patterns, you look at the themes, the energetic themes that are going on with you. The way that I work, I don't use any tools. But when I was younger, when I was in my 20s, I always used cards. I used to have to hold the person's hand.
Okay.
But as I developed over the years, I don't need any tools. Like, I can read anybody, anywhere. It doesn't matter who it is, because I understand that we're all connected. So because I understand that we're all connected and there's no separation, everything's energy, we're all one, that allows me to move my awareness from this room to anywhere with anybody.
Teddy, I asked that because what he does is totally different than Psychic Wayne. So I wouldn't want anyone to go to him and go, what my job going to do for me next week? Because that's not what he does.
Yeah, I wouldn't tell him that. I would probably say to them, this is what's going on with you and why you're not happy with your job. See,
so then it would be up to you to fix it.
What I do is I hold a mirror up to people so they can see themselves clearly. They see the shit, but then they see their wholeness. And then they can see that's why I've been unhappy, because I'm not even doing what I want to do. And this is what I really want to do. And for some people, they like that. A lot of people can't handle you holding up a mirror to them because they're not ready to see who they really are.
When you said there's angels or loved ones, your angel could be your loved one, right? Or do we all have another angel that isn't connected?
We all have an entourage. We all have a spiritual entourage that's with us. And we have angels that, by definition, angel means messenger. But I see them as like these beings of light that are unconditionally loving, that have never lived in a human body. And I just see them as expressions of the one source, they're angels. You know? And so there's angels. They see things from a higher perspective. A lot of times angels are like overseers of our soul path, of our soul journey, but they work in conjunction with our family members and with our ancestors. Believe it or not, we all have ancestors that go all the way back to like Africa that are working with us. And we know this is a fact because we know in, huh?
They help us make this real.
Right? Okay. Come on, ancestors. What you gotta do?
Right. Some bongos.
What you gotta do?
Have you ever been to a psychic just to see what they would say? And can you tell if like
I have, but because I'm not arrogant at all. I just take what I do extremely serious, and I'm a perfectionist. A lot of people are just undisciplined psychics and mediums, and they're not developed. So I've gone to people, and because they're not developed, they're not able to access deeper information. So I'll give you an example. Like, let's say you get a reading, right? And, you know, you go to the person and they're looking at you and they're like, you know, I know that there's a sadness with you, and I know that, you know, you're frustrated right now, and, you know, you need to relax, and I want you to just think positive thoughts. That's just on the surface.
Right.
More you develop, you can go deeper. You know, like if I wanted to go deeper with you, one of the first things I would talk about with you is relationships and what's out of balance. But I'm just saying, that's what I would talk about, right? And so that's a general statement, but then I would go deeper into more specifics if we were working together, and I would talk about the problems in the relationship that are showing up, what's bothering you, but then I would talk about the root causes of what the root causes that are showing up in your relationship, because the two are connected. So that would allow you to see, this is why I'm getting triggered. This is why this is happening. I can do something about it, and we can bring things back into balance. So that's the difference between, you know, street psychics or people that really haven't worked on themselves. See, I've worked on myself for a long time. I've worked through a lot of pain, a lot of stuff. So it allows me to go really deep into for others. If I haven't worked on my own traumas, what am I going to be able to tell you?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
So,
that's dope.
Yeah.
Tangie, go ahead.
No.
I stopped you two times.
Oh, well, I talked to Savon, and I got testimonies already.
But again, so going back to when you asked me that question, and you were talking right away, like my awareness starts to come to you. And what I'm doing is I just see myself in you because I know you're my sister. I know we're connected. So because I know that and I bring that energy into it, it allows me to form a bond with you. So then I get to know what's going on with you because then I start to feel it. I can feel what you're going through. That's why I started talking about that. That's why I picked that topic.
Don't tell
right? them. And that's what I thought. That's how it works. That's how it works. Yeah. And it's not anything scary. Yeah. It's meant to empower you.
Yeah.
It's meant to help you have a greater understanding so then you can make the best possible choice. Because the issue that I find that most people have is their choice making. What's driving you to make certain choices that's leading you to certain experiences? Mm-hmm. So if we can understand what the root causes are, which is how I use my gift, then you can shift that and shift your choice making and shift how you experience life, what you manifest, what's going on in your relationships. But if you don't know and someone's just saying things are going to get better, light this candle, do this, do that,
right,
but you haven't done the work, then 6 months later, right. And so, again, we all work differently, but that's how I work. I'm always trying to get to the root of the cause, and my intention is always, how can I leave this person feeling empowered, being in your power to the point where you're like unfuckwithable?
That's me, unfuckwithable.
Right? And the only way that that can happen is if you become aware of what's going on with you at a deeper level,
right,
and I'm able to deliver it to you in a compassionate way. Right, I'm able to say things that might not be feel positive to hear about yourself, but I'm sharing it in a loving manner.
Right.
Not like how Ayanna Van Zant does it, and I'm not shading it. I'm just using it as an example.
Yeah.
But right.
You gotta
so
be
that's
strong,
how I work. I just work yeah. off of love and compassion, and my whole thing is like, how can I empower people, and how can I make them aware? You know, like I know you're psychic. I know you're intuitive, but I know you don't listen to yourself. I know that. You know, it's all over you. Purple is all over you. Purple is a psychic color. That tells me a lot about you without even you saying anything.
Psychic came to me.
You know, and we all have psychic ability. We just don't listen.
So we all have a color around us?
Everybody has color.
Okay, so what's Tangie's color?
Tangie's color is orange.
What's mine?
Wait, ask him what it means.
Oh, what's orange mean? Sorry.
So, what it means?
I care what it means.
I do. I'm
gonna orange. So this is the thing. There's general meanings for all colors.
Okay.
But when I see a color around somebody, it means something different for me.
Okay.
So the orange for Tangie represents her love for creativity. And also, I know that she's happy and excited right now. She comes here.
She is.
She's happy and excited.
She lied to us.
Because it gives her an outlet. This is like her creative outlet. It's like the one thing that she can do that just lets her be herself. And so, and I told you this in the park, that, you know, everybody has a soul essence color. And her color is orange. It's a color of creativity, expressed creativity.
Okay, Pam.
Okay.
Don't mind this color.
The two colors I get with you.
Oh, you too?
I see two. I see pink.
Uh-huh.
But that just lets me know that your mother's here.
Uh-huh.
Your mother's
okay.
Your mother's love is like all over you. Uh-huh. So I know that, you know, you need that right now.
Yeah.
You need to feel her love. You need whatever it is that's going on. You just need that. So that's the first thing.
I have been missing her so much lately.
See?
Because
the colors also will tell me things. So just like Psychic Wayne uses tarot cards, I just use colors or I just go off of what I'm experiencing. So, but there's blue that comes in.
Uh-huh.
And so blue is a color of communication.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So I know that you're a person, you know, you need transparency.
Yes.
You don't like, no, I'm going to curse because it's a
real
life show. And I don't get a chance to curse. You don't like fuck shit. Like,
right,
you know,
absolutely.
People need to be upfront with you.
That's
me.
Yeah.
You know? Through.
Yeah. But I also know, like, career-wise, it's all about communication and making a difference using your voice. Mm-hmm. I know that you're passionate about that because around the blue, there's a little bit of the green. The green tells me that there's a humanitarian quality to your personality and to you, that you actually give a shit about people and about what goes on.
What? Nick and Pam? You telling secrets.
Don't give a fuck about me.
Right? I mean, if you could say I'm wrong if I
No, you're 110%.
You're right.
And when you say my mom, that is my mom through and through. So that's the pink. And
yeah.
So I am definitely a living spirit of her.
And the last thing I'll say is, you know, the blue and the green together, those are like connective colors. So I know that you're a connector. You have a way of bringing people together.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
I do.
You have a way of bringing people together and linking people up. Mm-hmm. You know, if somebody wants to network with somebody or find something.
That's so true.
The best person to call is you because you're like the resource for all of that.
That's me. Mm-hmm. That's on.
And that's a pink. That's a gift.
Okay. What's Speedy's color?
What is it, pink?
It's more of a mom.
It's more of
it's
a
like
mom.
A lavender.
Passion pink.
Lavender. Fuchsia.
Passion pink. That's sweet.
Speedy's color. There's orange there, but it's not the main color. It's not the dominant color. It's red. Yeah. And so this is cool because I love working with colors. So I'll tell you the general meaning of red, but then I'll go more into like the specifics. So red is it's a leadership color.
Ooh.
It's a color of a person that you once they make up their mind, you can't change their mind. But they don't like being told what to do.
Ooh, facts.
They have their you have your own way of doing things.
Mm.
You also don't want to work for nobody, can't work for nobody. Like, even if you were in a situation, eventually y'all going to fight over something and you're going to either get fired or quit. And so what's dope about the red is it's also, you know, for you, it's the color of a person that tends to bear the weight of responsibility for a lot of others. So I know you carry a lot of others.
Yep.
And the reason why
Everybody
you do is because, again, you're designed to be able to do that because the colors tell me what qualities exist within you to be able to handle that, right? And so the red also tells me that you're, you know, very passionate about your relationships. You're passionate about anything that you do. And if your heart's not in it, you're just not going to do it.
That's
true. Speedy.
That's
you know, I also know that, you know, whether people know this or not about you, I know that you lead with your heart.
He does.
Yeah.
He does.
Because that also, because that tells me.
Me with the stump.
The red tells me. That too.
Wait, now it's moving.
That's funny.
Red saber.
You know, and what was I going to say? I lost my train of thought.
Leads with his heart.
You lead with, you're a person that leads with your heart. I also know, you know, that. So this interesting about the red. Red is the color of love. So red is very similar to pink in that there's a sensitivity within the red, right? So I know that you're sensitive. I also know that you feel things as well.
No,
you know. But what's cool about the red, like I said, it's like it's this outer shell of strength, but contained within that is all the sensitivity that someone would need to be in their heart and live from
it's
their
gooey.
Heart.
Oh, nice.
Right.
Soft.
Oh,
so
like
a Pop-Tart.
Yeah, like
a Pop-Tart.
Yeah. Today, would his color change?
His color would still be red, but it would be a more intense red. So the red that I see around Speedy is a scarlet red. You know?
That's cute.
So, and I also know that Speedy is a person that wants to make a difference. Because the scarlet red, to me, is a red that's combined with the white to lighten it, to highlight it.
You knew it was going to be some white in there.
So that tells me.
Somebody in the chat room said if he had said Speedy's color is white, they would have fell out.
That's fine.
White is not a color.
But so I know that there's a need and desire to care for others, to take care of others, to make sure others are okay.
That's true.
I don't want you to take care of me. Can I have some gas?
Before yourself. So I know he puts other people before him sometimes. It's just how he is. It's just his heart.
He has the biggest heart.
You know, and not everybody can do that, but that's how you were created. That's you know. And so the orange that I talked about earlier is an outlet for you, where for her, it's like an expression. For you, it's more of an outlet. So
comedy.
The creative things that you do are an outlet for you.
Yeah.
Right?
You being here is an outlet for him. I know
yeah.
that. That's why he wants to be here every day.
Yeah, and I know because the orange comes after the red, I know that it's not just an outlet for you, but that's also something that you use to be able to help other people, to touch other people. When I remember earlier, I referenced the red and the white and how you want to make a difference with people. And so you use comedy in that way. That's where it stems from because yep. of what you went through when you were younger.
He always says laughter is the
healing.
Right? Yeah. Because healing. Comedy was your escape. So because it was your escape when you were younger from your circumstance, and I don't need to go into all that, but because it was escape touched. When you were younger, that became what you use to also help other people escape. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
It's beautiful. Right?
Okay, to the chat room, they love, this is our little sex and wellness show. They want to know Nick's color.
Can you see Nick's color through the glass?
Blue. Pop-Tart Pop.
Nick's color is green. I saw blue at first, but that's because I know he's a teacher. He likes to teach.
Oh, my God.
There's a need to teach people. And his blue actually comes in with yellow. So yellow, for me, is the divine mind. So I know he likes to teach and impart wisdom to other people. There's a need to be able to do that at a soul level. It's not just something that he does because he read a couple books and now he wants to sound deep. It's in him. He's called to do that. Uh-huh.
That's what me and Brady
on a deeper level.
About us.
And so, but deeper, the color that I see in his heart is green, is a beautiful emerald green. Aww. So I know that's the color of the humanitarian. It's the color of a
turtle green.
He's a humanitarian, you know, and he's here to help make a difference in humanity through his communication, through his teachings, also through his creativity, because it's all connected. It's like creativity is the bait, and then we get you in, and now I'm going to, like, drop this knowledge and drop this wisdom. And so, you know, green is the color, the humanitarian. I know that he's sensitive. You know, I know that he's not going to involve himself.
Follow your dad.
His heart isn't. If his heart's not in it, he ain't doing it.
That's true.
And people that are green are also natural intuitive. So I know the vibe ain't right. Like, he's not messing with it.
That's true.
Ain't messing with
it's him. All about the vibe with Nick. That's very true.
What about Sky?
Ain't no fuchsia Sky. Pop in my circle. Just like Pop Tart Pop.
Does it get mixed up because the baby's on
it? No. Sky's color is orange, but there's also another color. There's orange and red. So orange tells me that, you know, Sky in general cannot be put into a box or any parameters.
That's Sky.
She doesn't like, you know, you can't put no labels on her.
Not at all.
She's
her own individual.
Never work.
I know that you see the world very differently from other people.
Yep.
You know, but that's how your mind works, because you're creative. At your soul, your heart level, you're creative. You're here to be creative. And you're here to use your creativity to make a difference. I also know that just like Speedy, where the comedy was a relief for him, with you, creativity was a way for you to disconnect from your environment.
Wow.
Because I know that there's things, I'm aware of it, things that you saw, things that you experienced. Okay. You needed a way to escape. And so the tunnel of escape for you was creativity, right? Mm.
So, in the actual tunnel.
And so what's so beautiful about this is, you know, sometimes we grow up and we have, like, we all grew up in the hood of the projects, some of us, and so sometimes we feel like damn, why was my life this way? Why did this happen? But as you can see with Speedy and with you, and even with me, I grew up in the projects in the South Bronx. My mom was in prison most of my life. Your childhood and those circumstances contributed to your gifts blossoming. You know, and I always say that the shit in our life serves as fertilizer for our souls to blossom.
Oh, wait a minute. And the shit in our life serves as fertilizer for our souls to blossom.
In our lives serve as fertilizer for our souls to blossom. And the fragrance is what we share with others. So what I'm doing right now is I'm sharing my fragrance with you. That too.
The boo-boo fragrance.
So around the orange is the red, but then there's blue. So I know that there's your creativity will best serve you through communication, express communication.
Yes.
Right. So doing anything else isn't going to serve your soul. Because I see the blue
she
and
be
then
trying,
the red.
She be
the red tells me that
up.
It has to be your own stuff. You have to lead. You have to do it on your own. Like that's how you are. You can
that's
work
true.
For other people and involve yourselves, but eventually you're going to get bored because it's not feeding what you want to do. So, and the only thing that I would say is, you know, there's brown that I'm aware of, but the brown for me represents your own fear of stepping into your greatness. Because the thing is, you're not going to be ready until you decide that you're ready.
Hear that? Say it again one more time.
You're not going to be ready until
you decide that you're ready.
Because the juice is already there. Like, you already got the juice.
Thank you.
We all got the juice. The biggest thing, like I said earlier, is it's our own mind. What do we think and feel about ourselves and about our gift that's getting in the way? So you get to qualify yourself now if you want to. Or you can just sit back and keep being, you know, you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, that's what I would say to Sky. But to the thing that I was saying earlier, because I know a lot of people are listening. I know a lot of black people are listening. You know, we've all gone through stuff in our lives. And what I wanted to say, what I was saying earlier, is a lot of times we feel stuck, we feel like we don't know how to make it through or achieve some goal because we keep playing the same record in our mind over and over and over again about something that happened when we were younger, something that happened to my mom, my dad. But it's like if you look at a painting and it looks terrible, but then you flip it over and then it turns into like this beautiful piece of art. You have to look back at your past like that. Like if you look back over all the things that happened to you, it actually has contributed to your greatness and contributed to the good qualities and contributed to your gifts and everything. So I grew up in the hood. I grew up with my grandmother, 6 kids on welfare, South Bronx, around a bunch of crackheads and drug addicts. My mom went to prison when I was 4. She got out when I was 12. She died when I was 14. She died of AIDS. My uncle died of AIDS. They were all crackheads. So I grew up around a lot of fights, police being called, you know, feel a sense of abandonment, never knew my father, didn't even know I was biracial until I took a damn DNA test when I turned 40, and I was like, damn, like, y'all could at least tell me who my daddy was. But, so, again, all this stuff happened. Now, I could just go through life being depressed, or I could actually look at that and say, all these things have happened in my life, but they've actually contributed to me. I'm much more sensitive. I actually care about people because no one cared about me. You know, I actually trust myself and I learned to be self-reliant because I didn't have anybody to rely on. I learned to look people in the eye and actually be there for people and be present with people because nobody was present with me. So my past has prepared me for everything that I'm doing now.
And yours too, people.
And everybody that's listening. So I just want to drop that.
Save us on fire right now.
On fire.
Can you read kids?
He said he doesn't like it because it's out of integrity for me. And the reason is, it's a baby. And they literally just got here, right? And so nobody knows what that baby's going to do yet. I could say, but who am I?
Yeah.
You know? And also, a lot of what that child will end up doing has a lot to do with what they experience in their adolescence, who they're around, who their role models are, the choices that they make.
So what age,
you know,
what age could you like start right. at?
If you need me, reach out. Okay, all right.
Bye, Sky.
Bye, Sky.
Bye, Sky.
Well,
I'm sorry. Bye,
you, like,
Blue.
Start at?
Bye, Red, Blue. Brown.
Red, Blue, Blue.
So I did a reading once for someone that was like 17.
Okay, so.
But the mom was there, and I did an event. I flew out to like New Jersey or something. I can't remember. To Chicago, and this girl drove like 2 hours to come see me, and she was crying when she met me, and I was thankful. But I was just like, I don't know if I could read her. And her mom, like, I talked to the mom, and I was like, this is how it works, and I don't know if I can do this. She was like, no, I trust you. So I did it, and the mom was present, but I would rather wait for it to be an adult, because sometimes in a reading, there's personal things that get brought up, and you have to be in a space where you can handle it, right? So there's sometimes I might bring up a rape or an abuse or an abortion, or personal information.
And the mama might not know.
And the mother may not know, or the individual may not have reached a level of maturity where they can handle that. Because I don't know what's going to get brought up in a reading. My prayer is, help me to touch them and to bring through whatever you want, Spirit, so they can heal and be empowered. So there's personal information, things that you probably didn't think about, haven't thought about since you were like 5, that might get brought up. And so if I'm reading someone that's 14, they can't handle that. Yeah. And that would be irresponsible on my part.
So even with adults, like, sorry.
No, it's okay.
She's in my seat. Go ahead.
It's an aging hour.
If you feel, like, if you're talking to an adult and you feel like they can't handle it, will you still say it or you won't?
No. Okay. So when I'm working, first of all, when I do my work, people don't realize this. It takes a lot of energy for me to do what I do.
Yeah.
Because I have to be aware of myself, but then I have to be aware of what's going on with the other person and everything that they're feeling, and I have to make sure I separate me from them so I can be accurate.
Right.
But also, I have to discern how much I'm going to share. And I just know that. Like, I know how deep to go with people. That's why I knew, like, to not get too deep in her business, because you don't like your business being out there like that. But she didn't have to tell me. But I could feel that. So I read. So when people book sessions with me, I know right away if it's going to be a good session or a not so good session. I refund people's money back and say, I'm not right for you.
Wow.
Because I'm not interested in making money. I've modeled. I've worked for big companies. I have a computer science degree. I know how to hustle.
And anybody got money. Did y'all hear that? Computer science degree.
I stole money. I'm not interested in money. Amazing. My goal is to touch people. So if someone pays me and I know that they're not ready or I'm not going to be able to help them, I'm not going to take their money, because I still have to answer to my supervisors, which is Spirit. I got to look myself in the mirror. And so I can't do that.
Yeah.
I can't do that, because the reason why I'm here, I was going to commit suicide, but I had a spiritual awakening. Mm-hmm. So I know that I'm here now because Spirit saved me and my gift came out. So I can't act unethically.
Right.
So I read it. I kind of know sometimes when people are coming to me how deep to go, how far to go. Sometimes people have relationship issues. I know to just talk about the relationship issues and skim over a little bit of how they're contributing to the imbalance, but I know that they're not ready to deal with their childhood trauma.
Right.
And it may take them another year to deal with it. You know, and I've had situations where, you know, I used to live in Australia and I did a reading for someone and she wanted to talk about her relationship, but her father came through and she kept saying, I don't want to talk about my father. And I said, look, I don't have any control, because my mind belongs to your dad for this next hour.
Yeah.
And he wants me to talk about this stuff, and I can't focus on your relationship. So I started telling her stuff her dad was saying about her boyfriend, and she didn't want to hear it. But I said it anyway, because in that particular instance, the father came through, and once they show up, I have to honor them, because it takes a soul a lot of energy and effort to impress on me what they want to say, and me to receive it and say it. But in that instance, so every case is different. Sometimes people need to hear the words, because later it's planting a seed in their own mind of what they already know is true, but there's just cognitive dissonance happening, and they're not willing to.
Oh, great words.
They just don't want to accept it, but they know I'm telling the truth.
Right.
They want, and sometimes people want me to tell them what they want to hear, and that's not my job, because that's not going to empower anybody.
Right.
You know?
We got phone calls.
So.
FYI, he doesn't have a curl. That's his real hair.
Caller, what's your name and where you calling from?
My name is Dana, and I'm calling from Pasadena.
Hey, Dana.
Hey, Dana.
Hey, I have a question
Hey, Dana, what's going on?
Okay, so this is my question. I wanted to ask about when you have recollection of where your parents. Like, a lot of times I meet people and I know them somewhere, but we've never been around each other, we've never looked at the same thing. I have a lot of visions of deja vu.
Deja vu's, like if you walk into a room and you just know, I know this person, I've met this person.
Or you
before.
Felt it.
Or you felt it.
Okay.
Like when I met my baby dad, that's my baby dad.
We were talking about, this was a discussion earlier, Savion, because Angie was explaining to Beanie and Pam about knowing who you are before you meet.
Oh, okay.
I have a lot of instances of where I'm familiar with people, but I don't know them, I never
got
met
it.
Them. I'm one of those people that if I met you, I might not remember your name, but I know I saw you. I know
okay.
I know
you. Okay, so this is what I feel and what I think, but take my answer with a grain of salt because, you know, there could always be other answers. So remember earlier when I was, you know, talking about how what allows me to do what I do is because I know at a soul level we're all connected. Yeah. There's no separation in spirit. The only thing that separates us are our bodies. When someone has a natural connection or is in tune with their own soul, oftentimes before they meet people, they become aware of them on some level, whether it's a subtle level, a conscious level, or unconscious level. And then when you see them in person, it's almost like, you know what, I know you, or I knew that I was going to meet you. Does that make sense?
It does.
Because, so this is what I want to say to that. That tells me, if that's happening with you, that tells me that you're a person. You know, you're spiritual. So you either must meditate or have a process or something that you do that helps to tune you back into you. And there's a need to just stay in alignment and to stay in a balanced state. And when we're in alignment and in a balanced state, a lot of times, even before we realize it, we might start to feel the person that we're going to run into at 3 o'clock in the afternoon at 8 in the morning. Does that make sense?
It does make sense. My color is.
Yeah, blue is communication, divine communication, but there's also violet around you as well, so I know that there's a desire within you for, you know, for metaphysical, spiritual information to really understand the deeper meanings behind life. Does that make sense?
It does, and that's why I left the church 5 years ago, because it wasn't for me, or I had graduated to
a certain point where I was gone. Yeah, now I want to say this too, because there's also indigo. Tells me, just like there's a need for information, indigo is the color of like the seeker and the searcher. So that tells me that you're open to experiencing other spiritual things to try to figure out where do I fit, what's true for me, what makes sense. So if you're drawn to taking classes or workshops or reading other books or looking at, right, so that tells me that the indigo, that tells me that about you. The indigo is also, you know, indigo and violet can be a lonely color. And what I mean by that is, you know, people that have indigo and violet, sometimes they can be around people, but they still feel like they're on their own planet because other people just aren't on your frequency and they don't get it.
Yeah.
And the thing
I
is,
to my own drummer.
That
right.
is a gift because, you know, you're a way shower. And a way shower is a person that might be tuned in and tapped into something else, a higher level of truth. But you're here to be that example, but to share that with other people, right? Because, does that make sense?
It all makes sense.
Okay,
it
perfect. Because not everybody's going to always get you, but they don't need to. As long as you get you, and as long as you're cool with that, that's it. So I hope that answered your question.
It does, and I'm very much a person. When you meet me and I start talking or we have a conversation, you either click with me or you don't.
Right, because you have your inner BS detector is going to tell you.
I'm also a Sagittarius.
Me too.
Yeah. So what? Bye.
They said Speedy's colors are.
Bye, baby.
Speedy's colors are golden arches.
And with that in mind, it is now. Can you
hang out with some men?
No, he has to slip out.
Oh, okay.
I got acupuncture.
Okay, give me information.
Savon Champagne, www.
SavonChampagne.com. You can find me on my website. You can find me on YouTube. So I want to say this really quickly. I have like over 300 videos that I've done. People are always writing me and asking for help. How do I connect to my angels? How do I tap into my intuition? How do I get over my ex? Any topic that you probably want to know about, go to my YouTube channel. Just type in my names. There's videos. There's meditations. It's all free content that I put out to empower people. You can find me on Instagram under Savon_Champagne. I'm constantly posting things to teach people, to empower people. Yeah, thank y'all for having me. This is a blessing.
Thank you so much.
Seriously, I love my people, and I love when I have an opportunity to share with my people because I don't get a chance to do that. 90% of my clients are usually like white people or people from Europe or Germany.
Yeah.
And I wanna try to like change that and shift people's mindset around.
Hey, you shifted our mind.
For real. Hey, Brittany,
love you.
Can you make sure he signs the wall too? We got the picture.
Oh, I didn't get a picture with him.
Put some aluminum foil on it.
Oh,
TV junkie, what you watching? TV junkie.